Hello, everyone, and welcome to the hall. Thank you all so much for joining us today, and sorry for the technical glitch that we had at the start. We had some issues with our platform. But welcome and good evening to the Rashmi Talk Show. I'm Lily Max Hager. I am Up Project's digital commissions and events producer. I am a white woman with long brown hair, and I'm wearing a turtleneck and a silver necklace. My pronouns are she, her. This event launches Up Project's latest digital project, Rashmi by Sonia E Barrett, that investigates ideas around migration, belonging, identity, and hybridity, and aims to build greater empathy with the Windrush generation by taking a long view of the many ways West Indian people have moved and been moved to serve British interests. Rashmi is an interactive digital space hosted in Hubs Mozilla. The space presents three different routes for exploration that delve deeper into the themes of healthcare, transport, and military assistance, some of which Sonia will expand on tonight. The talk show highlights how the skills and lived experiences and creativity of people from the Caribbean have influenced and shaped British culture today, and I'm excited to have you join us for an evening filled with visual arts, poetry, prose, and music. I'm absolutely thrilled that today's events will be hosted by Jamz Supernova, DJ, broadcaster, label owner, A&R podcast host, who has worked with BBC Radio One Extra, BBC Six Music, BBC Four, the British Council, and many, many more. I'm also very excited that she will be joined by award-winning Trinidad-born poet, novelist, academic, and musician Anthony Joseph, and artist Sonia E. Barrett, whom Jamz will introduce shortly in more detail. But before I hand over to the team, I would like to very quickly run through some virtual housekeeping. For those of you who are dialing in via computer, people dialing in via phone, please bear with us for a short moment. If you experience any technical issues during the event, please use the chat function at the bottom of your screen to chat with our dedicated tech support. Any questions, please submit them there. We have British Sign Language interpretation available for this event. So if you need a BSL interpreter, please let us know and we will help you out if you cannot access that already. I do hope you enjoy the event today, and I'm now very pleased to hand over to Jamz to kick off the event.
Thank you very much, Lily. So yeah, here we are to celebrate the work of Sonia E. Barrett, her Rashmi project, which I'm going to hand over to her in just a second. And just like Lily said, we have some readings from the author and poet and academic, Anthony Joseph. So it's very exciting, and was really compelled to be a part of this project to really sort of delve into the experience of Windrush and how that has further impacted generations and generations. So I'm going to hand over to Sonia E. Barrett to talk about Rashmi and kind of give you an insight into the digital world that she's created.
Hello, thanks so much, Jamz. It's just amazing to be introduced by you. Thank you very much, Lily, and thank you Art Projects for facilitating this work. I'm just going to share a little bit about Rashmi. So Rashmi is really a project that started in a virtual space. Really, we start in it's like four different rooms. And when you come in, you enter into this place. It's a mashup of all these different types of transport spaces, including the iconic Windrush. And the thinking behind this work is, what if we were to think about the call for help as opposed to like celebrating the answering the call? What if we really to think about the call, or maybe the audacity of the call? So Rashmi looks at cycles of Black people rushing and being rushed internationally by the British government in Britain, Africa, and the Caribbean. So in this first introductory room, there's a cold wind that whistles through it in the sound. In the center is a 2-minute film, which is based on a poem that expresses some of the things that are almost impossible to articulate about the relationship between Africa, the Caribbean, and Britain. It does so using lots of snippets from popular media. In the film, we meet three figures. These three figures are here in the center of the screen. They make a demand in the film. So the one on our left is, "I demand you transport us at once." The central figure says, "I am sick." This figure to the right says, "I want to fight." And these are the three kind of calls for help from the British government that I wanted to drill down into: the call for to help with healthcare, the call to help with military, with fighting, and the call to help with transportation. these rooms are, you drop into them through a trapdoor. And that's a picture of the film, another slip from the film. You can see Rashmi is always written in this kind of capture text, which is the text in digital spaces that is used to try to distinguish humans from robots. And in this way, the digital space is really interesting because it kind of parallels the Black experience in that in many ways there's this confusion about whether we're human or not, and always this question of, you know, how can we prove our humanity? Or is that all to do with labor? So if we can enter into the first room, which was really the healthcare room. So the healthcare room is deep blue and brown. It contains seas and moving water, and pieces of tropical hardwood furniture fly continuously through the air. So it's a very dynamic space. So there are images and audios to activate, and I share like kind of intergenerational differences about healthcare in terms of my own family. So I share that my grandmother left my father behind in Jamaica to nurse Black people, to nurse British people in England, and that my great-grandmother, who raised my father, actually never left Jamaica, but she had the medicinal knowledge to cure my father of a dangerous fever that he had using bush tea. So what we see here is a pre-colonial intact society on the African continent with the medicinal space on the left, and that's the forest. So it's very challenging to find documentation of African healthcare systems, pre-colonial African healthcare systems, but similar forest societies in Southeast Asia used up to 6,500 plants for medicinal purposes. Tropical medicinal plants are potent and effective. I mean, half the medicines in Britain originate from plants and trees in tropical forests. So the decimation of, we see lots of images in this space, but there's another image which shows that how this space is decimated, and basically all this space is seen as unproductive. The trees are felled and turned into mahogany furniture, which is shipped to Britain, and the place replaced with kind of cash crops. So basically, these spaces are destroyed. There's ever an environmental devastation to create space, to create cash crops to make cheap foods for Britain, but also the luxury kind of tables to put foods on. So the space is just, so this is a picture of the porch space. There's a space in the digital area to just rest and recuperate. We can look out. This is a porch that was sent to me by a community member from the Caribbean who sent that in. We have that opportunity to just be together in this space and reflect, because a lot of these issues are quite heavy. So this is a kind of rest space. So that's the space that where we stop rushing. Here this is a central space in the healthcare room, and we see just so many things happening here. So the first on the left, we see this mahogany chest, which is full of like kind of quack medicines from the time, some of which would actually have been dangerous, and many were very ineffective, but they're housed crucially in a mahogany box, and that box would have been felled in Africa or in the Caribbean, because we know that we were moved twice, and both of our healthcare spaces, both of our forest spaces were decimated. And in that box, like potentially ineffective or even dangerous and deadly medicines, but the tree that housed them would have shared about 4 square miles of forest with 749 species of trees and up to 1,500 flowering plants. Before destroying those forests, only 1% of those trees and plants were examined by the colonizers for medicinal purposes. Patents that we have now on the drugs that were found from, that were extracted from those tropical spaces, which is half of the drugs that are around in Britain today, were patented to the molecular level. And that's why there's a play on Damien Hirst's work on the right, which is his famous medicine cabinet, locked away because now we're as African and Caribbean people are unable to access these medicines because they've been painted to the molecular level. We can't afford to buy them. We can't afford to reproduce them without lawsuits. And that is just a situation that's just devastating. So there's this really interesting long look into what is healthcare beyond the call to come and help for health. What does that mean for, what else could it mean for us? At the back, we see here, this is another kind of thought about the recapture. So often you're asked in digital spaces to tick all the boxes that contain traffic lights to see if you're a human or you're a robot. And here, this is a different type of capture screen called evasion. And this is full of incredible healthcare people, black and brown people who work in healthcare, who have directed their energies towards black communities in specific, very generative ways. And they're all these people are listed, and they're all working in incredible in government and non-governmental NGO and voluntary and charitable sectors, all kinds of different ways, kind of really evading this will to always service healthcare needs of other people, really redirecting that back to the black community, which is chronically underserved by the health service that it's actually supported. Black people continue to have the worst outcomes in the NHS. So all this is all in the work. There are places to click, you can look in, and all these facts tumble out. It's been massive research to put all this together. At the back, you see earn, learn, and return, and that's really talking about contemporary recruitment from the Caribbean to help British healthcare, which continues to this day. The Earn, Learn and Return scheme is the latest scheme, which means that basically the deportation of members of the West Indian community is already built into their coming. So the idea is that it's supposed to earn, learn about healthcare and then return home. So in effect, deportation is already in the package. There's no need to then try to get rid of people by with visa problems. This whole room is like kind of the floor moves, so that's a kind of sea, and always we have all this mahogany moving through the space. So maybe if we could just click on through there. So this is the next room. So this is the military room. The military room is dark, red and quiet, but rapid action gunfire can be seen in the video that's just on the front there. It's quite dynamic because there's all these things floating around in space as well. So this room starts in here, and it's really a space of no valor. And it's very interesting because in the British military system, the highest order you can get is the Victoria Cross, which is for valor. And I thought, in my research, it was so interesting to see that there's that really the spaces of there was this, I would like to say, cowardly fighting in that, for example, the MAC gun is this machine gun, a rapid action machine gun, which, so the British soldiers would form a square around this machine gun and it would just decimate unarmed people. And it wasn't a fight with valor. And this always is, so this call, I want to fight, becomes I want to fight you, but only if I have overwhelming firepower, or as in the on the wall to the right, if I'm able to immobilize you with chains and ropes first. So maybe if we can maybe pass through this space and move into the space, and in the center of the space, I've just collected so many of the different types of military persons that are in the Caribbean, that these people have fought for the British Empire, against the British Empire, but also ruled over Britain in a military way. So there isn't really time to go into all these figures, but each figure can be clicked on, and they're so interesting to be all in the same space, sharing the same space. Maybe just to contrast to Joseph Johnson, who's a figure from 1850s Britain, who stands at the front there with a ship on his head. He's actually a veteran, a military veteran, a beggar, and one of London's most famous beggars, because he made this wonderful sculpture of a ship that he war on his head when he was asking for alms. There he is with his hat out. But he's also like one row behind him is Septimus Severus, who's the Roman Empire, who really decided whose military rule as a black man affected the city of London, almost define the city of London, that later Joseph Johnson is begging in. So there are all these different types of military actions, and it was just so interesting to put all these people in one space to just see how diverse the military has been, the hidden military history has been. So I've also looked at what is a weapon, and military weapons in terms of the Caribbean are so interesting. And there's and the right hand corner there, we've got the comb, we've got the drum, we've got the conch shell, there's also the torch, and all these were military weapons. I mean, so the way that the hair was done on a certain way would be a call to arms, as was the conch shell, but the hair patterns in the hair would also signal where, if you were to escape, where you would meet an impasse. It's really, really interesting. So the space, the military space, tries to expand the idea of what is military action. And exploding out of a picture of a plantation that's been torched are like all these objects that fly through the space. And those are objects that have been, if we could just go back to the last slide, objects that have been collected and donated to the World War effort, in terms of civilians in the Caribbean donated all these objects. So oranges, chocolates, crates. So they were literally supporting the military, not just also in the military as in serving, as you could see some of the servicemen in that space, in the central space, but the civilians from the Caribbean were also giving things of their own volition to support that war effort. So, and you can imagine how valuable like an orange would be in times of scurvy, where there's, you know, like in, that would be really important. So it's so interesting to see that. So there's this fighting against and supporting. So there's all these different types of military action happening. On the back wall of the military space, I've got a series of calls to enlist, starting from the one asking the young men of the Hamas, you know, what's wrong with you? Come and fight, enlist today, come and fight for empire, to contemporary campaigns, which particularly target black and brown people from Africa and the Caribbean in Britain. And it's just very poignant to think about after all the service that has happened to kind of like characterize potential recruits as self-obsessed or in some way, but then ask them to come to serve. And then the more recent campaign is here, this is belonging. And we see like an ethnically diverse group of people there in bombed out spaces. And given the history of black people not belonging or being told they don't belong in so many ways, and how that happens even today, it's rather poignant to see the British Army recruiting us by offering belonging. So maybe if we can move from the military space to the transport room. The transport room really digs into this question. We demand you transport us at once. And that call was really usually understood as the call to help to drive and conduct buses, trains and tubes in Britain. But this room kind of queers that understanding. So the transport room is canary yellow and deep orange. And we enter through the legs of a giant flag woman who dominates the space. And the flag woman is the woman who conducts the carnival. So flags really directed early European transport, ships and trains especially, but the carnival is a kind of transport that really breaks with European norms. So the destination is not the point, speed is not the point, linear movement is not the point. So I'm just so interested in Carnival and this particular, this direction of the female direction that's in Carnival. And this is a great image that was given to me. And I just really enjoyed having this flag woman here. And in the center of the room, is there is a gif that flashes and moves. I mean, so these are just stills of the space, but maybe later you can see the dynamic space. And this space has gifts that change, and the gifts show all the different ways, just put in one place, all the different ways in which we've been moved and transported, all the vehicles that are in that conversation, including the planes that people came on, the boats, but also the deportation vans and all the kind of campaigns against migrants in this country that have taken place using vehicles as well. To the left and the right of that moving gift are these two images. One is called By Ox and Hammock, and the other one is called the Rake's Progress. So it's two different pictures, basically showing one of Africans carrying wealthy white British men through the African continent. And on the right, we have working class white people in London carrying rich white men through the streets of London. So I was just so interested in this type of transport where we're moving. There's one particular person who's being moved in two very different places. But also we've got the fight for Belly Majinga, who worked as a British transport worked for British Transport and died of COVID as a result, and her campaign, she has never been compensated, or no, there's never been any compensation paid. And we have Erlkoff, who's one of the first bus drivers in London long before Windrush. But maybe the thing is that the superiority of of motorised transport is questioned in this room, and the spiritual significance of roads and routes in Caribbean and African context is considered. And I think that that's a really nice another way to think about transport and maybe our contributions, or not even just our contributions, but who are we in relation to transport, without thinking about what we are doing for Britain. So I'm not sure if there's another shot there of anything at that point. Yes, at the back there is another wonderful flag woman. That flag woman is actually Lord Kitchener's, the flag woman for Lord Kitchener. She's seated there, and it's quite interesting because she's not going anywhere. That's her name is Janet Lewis. And I think that's all.
Amazing. Wow. I mean, the level of detail in that, I think it's really nice that you actually got to hear Sonia talk you through each room and kind of the significance behind all the work and the images and the questions posed, and we'll delve a little bit deeper into it. But I did have one question for you, Sonia, and I guess it was, why did this commission speak to you? Why did you want to do this?
Oh, so I really want to make sculpture. I really want to be commissioned to make sculpture, but for me, this digital space really spoke to me, because I just think there's so much about the digital and the Black experience, and I really think kind of Keith Piper has worked a lot on it, and I just really felt like this is something else like that I could contribute. And all the questions that there are around the Windrush and how to contextualize the Windrush, which has this particular focus, to ask questions that are relevant to us today, because we've got so many important things that we need to, as a community, to think about and to dig into and act on. So many urgent things to act on, that I just feel like it was just a wonderful opportunity to take Windrush as an idea and to really expand it into now and think about the past, and that maybe in all that information and questions, there'll be some answers for us as a community. I mean, what I didn't say is what's so exciting about the digital space is that it's a space where we could all enter, and it's a space that's evolving. So there are shelves, people can leave things, people can test things in the room, we can bring more information in. And I think that's the kind of community involvement and action we really need around the idea of Windrush. That's why I just like absolutely so happy to do this.
Yeah, we're going to have some questions in, so feel free to, whilst we're going through this too, think of the questions that you want to ask directly to Sonia, if anything sort of resonates with you or you want to dig a little bit deeper into something, we can do that towards the end. And we us two are going to have a kind of like, you know, a deeper delve into the work as well. Okay, so I'm going to play a song and then we're going to come back and we're going to hear some work from Anthony Joseph and a chat with him. I'm going to play you a song by a tuba player from the UK called Theon Cross. And a lot of his work is influenced by his father, who was a sound system man, and this song is called Back to Africa. So this song is by Theon Cross, it's called Back to Africa, and it serves as a musical interlude, and I think it was about the duality of feelings that this song evokes. It's something really happy about it, there's something really celebratory about it, but there's a sadness to it as well. So I'd like to introduce Anthony Joseph now to do a little reading, and we'll have a chat after. Anthony, the floor is yours.
Hi, thank you. I'm going to read something from a book that I published in 2018, which was a biography of Lord Kitchener. So I'm going to read a chapter called London is the Place for Me, which I guess is an attempt to reinterpret that famous Pathé footage of the Windrush arriving. I mean, we can talk about this after, but yeah, I was kind of tired of seeing the way the whole film is shot, you know. So I decided to sort of reinterpret it for this book. So this is London is the Place for Me. 4 day dawn, the sky is ashen gray. The sea washes from the waters and the river begins to lash at the ship's bow. Estuary. The water here is dank and slow and dour, like the scent of snakes and damp country bush. Along the Tilbury coastline, there are dark and sleeping hills. A few factory chimneys that pout fog, blink lights, saplings and crab apple trees, marshland and the fisheries, portside warehouses and shippers' offices. The morning opening, sickly, diseased and dull, silt. The white foam forms a trail, the engines churn through sediment of oil and blackness. Dark figures, the crowd, the prow of the ship. Black faces peering from the top deck. Some have footholds in the riggings, others hold their hats and jackets shut against the wind. Silhouettes mass, and then the buzzing hum of their voices traveling across the water. The ship begins to turn slowly into dock. It asserts its drafts and trim. It rests on its keel, and then the engines die with a groan. Those on the shore cannot fathom the depth of field. Likewise, as islands are often underestimated on maps by cartographers, so too the ship's true scope overwhelms the eye. The men on the boat can see the crowd gathered on the docks to meet them, and they wave. They put fingers beneath their tongues and whistle. They have seen shipyards and ships arriving before. They know what to do. Their faces are taut and starched by 6 weeks' sea blast. When they come down the gangways with their sea grips and baggage, their shoes are the only things shining in the dull light. A young man steps onto land. He feels the air with his face, tastes it with his open mouth, the sea smell, the moisture on the tongue. One suitcase or box case or bundle tie up with twine, the soft suit, the pastel colored seersucker shirt, the trilby, the brogues burnished from kneeling between the varnished pews on some evangelical Sunday morning in the tropics, with the breadfruit branch knocking on the roof of the sermon. But he stands here now on the wooden jetty, upright in England, the land he had imagined for so long. A photographer fixes his image, flash bites his eye. A reporter in a black wool coat, black hat, his red face round and impartial, pathé microphone in hand. He pulls his bulk up the gangplank onto the deck. There are a group of men there, leaning starboard on the top deck, smoking slow cigarettes, waiting for the jetty to clear so they could come down to England in style. He who sings is the center of their circle, and the reporter wants to see who stands among them with the song. The Calypsonian emerges to face the mic and camera eye. He wears a wide-brimmed trilby, fawn brown, pinched at the crown, a polywool suit in indigo blue with wide lapels and padded shoulders, black tie, crisscross patterns with white nether knot. The trousers are high-waisted and hold 2-inch folds. They fit so loose in the thigh that the sea breeze flaps the pleats. The camera operator sets his tripod on the roof of a car on the jetty below and zooms the image of the Calypsonian down to earth from the deck. What appears to be close in his lens is actually distant, and this is why the film stock cannot capture the fine details of the Calypsonian's face, the rigid bone, the cat-eyed blink. Instead, the image he records is dark and simple. Now, may I ask you your name, Lord Kitchener? Lord Kitchener, now I am told that you are really the king of Calypso singers. Is that right? Yes, that's true. Well, now, can you sing for us right now? Yes. London is the place for me, mimics the upright wood bass. London, this lovely city. The right shoulder rises, the beat runs down. You can go to France or America, India, Asia, or Australia, but you must come back to London City. Wood bass in the throat, the rolling country Baptist diction. Well, believe me, I am speaking broad-mindedly. I am glad to know my mother country. I've been traveling the countries years ago, but this the place I wanted to know, darling. Tap, tap of the beat against the railings, and his shoulders ducking and clenching, releasing the rhythm, the laveway, the drum. London, this the place for me. He can hardly contain the motion of his body, mimics the wood bass, the rattle of the cornbird's throat. Two verses is all he sings. The wind on the river blows up ghosts behind these men. Look how cold tightens their smile. And in the somber dim dawn, when the Calypsonian finally climbs down the gangway with his beige canvas suitcase, he looks to the sky, always the sky, but cannot find the sun. More smoke, smoke upon smoke upon smoke upon smoke upon smoke. Thank you.
Wow, amazing, really powerful, Anthony. Thank you so much for that reading. So that is from your book, which fictionalizes the biography of Lord Kitchener. Why do you think that moment has become so iconic? I mean, I've heard it word of mouth, I've seen it written, I've heard it in history books, you know, it's been retold and retold. Why?
Yeah. Why? I don't know. I think it was one of the first ones that sort of gained sort of widespread viewing. I mean, these were clips that were shown in cinemas, usually at the beginning of films and stuff, these newsreels. And what's interesting as well with this, a lot of people don't know, is that it's part the Windrush footage is part of a longer sequence. It's part of a longer film that includes a visit by Ingrid Bergman, who comes to the UK. So that's the first part of the film, and she's in an interview with Alfred Hitchcock. So I think a lot of people were drawn to that and to her and to Hitchcock and Bergman, you know, as she comes in, and that's part of the thing that is disturbing about the film, because we see her coming in looking, you know, quite beautiful. She's an actress, and Hitchcock commenting on how beautiful she looks, and you know, they have a conversation, really sort of, you know, casual conversation, because she's come here to do a film, I think, And then it suddenly cuts and it just goes to the ship and it says 500 Jamaicans come to England. And these men are shot in this kind of really distant distant way, as if they've come cap in hand to England, you know. But I think people were drawn to the Bergman back then. They might have been drawn to that. But now, I think one of the things that makes it really iconic is that Kitchener sings this "London is the Place for Me" song, which is, you know, a really pivotal moment, I think, for Black British history. I think it's the point where the colonial subject becomes the immigrant. It's a pivotal moment, you know?
Yes,
because prior to that, you know, we were Commonwealth citizens and we were, you know, we were in the islands, and then all of a sudden we're here, you know, and we've become immigrants, you know? So I think it's iconic for that reason. I think a lot of scholars and Black academics have seen it for that.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, your book fictionalizes Lord Kitchener. Was in it being fiction and not necessarily factual, did that give you freedom to explore other areas that you might not have been free to do?
Actually, the book is a biography. I call it a fictional biography because I tell the story using a lot of fictional means. So there's a lot of, you know, there's narratives and, you know, there's things that you might find in a novel, but the actual facts, it's true. It's really his life. So it's a fictionalized biography. So it's a biography rather than a work of fiction. You know what I mean?
Yes, I get it.
No, it's absolute biography. I did a lot of research. I started researching in 2000 when he died, up until it was published. So that like a long, over 10 years working, you know. What it did, instead of giving me free rein to sort of, I didn't invent anything. What I did was I told it I told some of the stories in a beautiful way, or I told them in ways that maybe people hadn't, you know, experienced it before. Just to put a different slant, like that sort of Windrush arrival thing. I wanted to tell it from another angle. I wanted to tell it from the point of view of the men, you know, tasting the air and feeling London. So there's things like that. And then there's another bit in it that I kind of reimagine an encounter Kitchener had in Brixton in a club, where someone grabbed the mic from him and told him, like, go back to the jungle or something like that. And that's always been something that I wanted to turn around and rewrite and sort of write it in history, you know what I mean? So
yeah
I do things like that, but it's essentially, you know, it's factual.
Yeah, I feel like that's kind of the, you want to paint an image and people can see that. And also, I guess it humanizes this character that we've built up in our head. And I guess my last question to you on this would be, having, you know, at the beginning of the book process to the end of the book process, Lord Kitchener and his meaning to you, what he means to you, did it change throughout that process?
Well, yeah. I mean, I learned a lot about him as a human being. I learned a lot about him as a man. Not everything I learned was great, you know, not everything, you know, was great, but it was really an exercise in being able to separate the man from his work, you know. His work took on deeper resonance for me because I learned a lot about his process and his genius as a Calypsonian and as a writer and as a performer and a poet almost. So I learned, again, a lot of respect for him. That went beyond just a superficial, oh, I love Kitchener's music, oh, he's great, you know, he's, you know, this ubiquitous presence in Trinidad, oh, Kitchener. I learned a lot about how he composed his music, and I learned a lot of stories about him as a performer and an artist. So that was great. But on the other hand, I learned a lot about him as a person, his personal life, which wasn't always favorable, but which, you know, gave me a sort of more rounded picture of who he was as a human being. And that was good. That's helpful, you know.
Both you and Sonia have referenced, you know, Lord Kitchener in your work, so I thought it'd be a good point here if we play some Lord Kitchener and we play Flag Woman. So I'm gonna get the up team to play it if they can.
Great.
My DJs.
Cool.
Lord Kitchener, Flag Woman, thank you for anyone that's just joined us. So we want to get through as many of your questions towards the end as possible. So Jack's just put in the chat, if you're not looking in the chat, a little link that you can click onto, and then you can write your questions in Slido, and then we'll be able to read them up towards the end. So I'd like to welcome back Sonia, whose work tonight we're celebrating. Sonia, I felt like that was quite an apt song to play to kind of link you and Anthony's work together, in that in the transport room in your digital space, we enter through the legs of a flag woman. And I really like the fact that, you know, in regards to transport, it wasn't the obvious means of transport. It wasn't like, here are the Caribbean people that came to do buses, to do this, to do that. It had a deeper level to it, and I think that I really like the duality sort of within the reference of carnival. You obviously have the, like you said, the movement of people, but what was the other layer that you wanted to use carnival for in terms of what it means for transport?
I was so interested, transport as in the way the carnival can transport us away, and that it's a type of, a kind of escape, but it's also a politically managed escape because it's a kind of vent. So there's this long history of like us being able to kind of vent this, and then carnival is over. But in terms of actual the physical movement, often it's a loop. And I like the way that, you know, the destination isn't the point. It's not the quickest, like the journey, it's all about the journey, isn't it? It's not about getting from A to B. And it's not about getting there in the most efficient way, which is a kind of very Eurocentric way of thinking. Was it actually the more, like if you think about dancing that route, it's like the most complicated moving back on itself kind of way of getting somewhere. And I think there's something very interesting in the kind of philosophy of that, that is that's a big contribution to kind of to transport. But I was also did a lot of research on kind of in pre-colonial space about the significance of the road, and especially in the shanty, the road has a significance, a cultural significance and a spiritual significance that is you know, really worth celebrating and something that's worth digging into as something to celebrate as well, and to think about in terms of community. So there's all of those layers, I think, and I tried to bring as much of it as I could into the space.
No, definitely. And I feel that, and I you know, it kind of brings me memories of, you know, even this year's carnival, like, you know, it wasn't about going to this stage and getting to that stage. Actually, the most fun we had was just in random roads that we didn't know where we were with DJs that we you know, we hadn't heard of, but that was the most fun. It's like you said, it's the journey. And I really was also sort of drawn to you know, it's a bit of a different, I guess it's a bit of a sensitive one for a lot of people, because if anybody knows of anyone that has come, when I say from the Commonwealth, but maybe on the other side of the Commonwealth, you know, there is this side of things that, well, they didn't have the wheel, so they weren't civilized, and when we got there, we civilized them, you know, and that as a way of kind of undoing the negatives of colonialism. It's like, well, we gave them this, we gave them that. And I thought, you know, in terms of like not having the will, in terms of the idea of them not knowing where they're going, even though this was where they live, sort of, I guess, eradicating their knowledge and the ignorance around that. I wondered how that still affects us today, that ignorance.
I think it's key. And I've got a space in the room where there are lots of wheels turning, and I really talk about how this lack of this idea that there was not mechanized motorized transport, it's always been seen as a sign of intellectual backwardness. And I think that affects like the fact that kind of it's a key tool. And you know, this distinction between animals and people is always that, you know, people use tools and animals can't. And so there's this sense of like, you know, Black people not being having tools or not creating these tools, whereby the wheel was really inappropriate for the continent because of the way rain is, and it wasn't appropriate technology, although obviously it was used as well. So I think this still affects us today. And I think but the interesting thing is that the first thing that was wheeled onto the continent of Africa was the gun carriage that I have in the military room. That was probably the first wheels that were brought, and then the other wheels that were, I mean, that's the kind of point that's made in the room. And then the fact that the trains and so on were mostly made to express things out of the continent as opposed to anything else. So it's not, it actually wasn't beneficial. And there's a space in the room where there's lots of wheels that are moving when I talk about administrative areas as being circular spaces. So it used to be that as far as you could walk in a day, that was an administrative region. So no to the wheel, but like, and anything else was considered like kind of crazy. Like, why would you want to administer an area larger than you could cover in a day, you know? And I just think that's so intelligent, and but it's just kind of all swept away in terms of, and so I think that how that relates to us today is that there are lots of ways in our community and in our spirit that we can have of thinking about things, of understanding things that we just don't even reach into. And you talk and these are powerful things. And it's so interesting you talk about like being at carnival, not knowing where you are, or not even knowing which float it is. And that's kind of the best moment. So this constant desire to locate, to be quick, to move quickly, to dominate, it's even to know where you are all the time is not, it's a construct that we can actually step outside of. And culturally, we do that in our cultural practices, and I think they're really powerful, and especially now with climate catastrophe or climate change, however you want to phrase that, I think these are tools that are going to be really important.
Yeah, most definitely. You sort of kind of led us nicely into the military room. You know, there was some sort of, I guess, there was a little bit of crossover with some of the first wheels that were, you know, kind of exported there and for the purpose of war. It was, you know, I only found out from my mum that Black people and brown people, you know, fought in the world wars that we talk about in school and we learn about in the history. And she was very kind of adamant that, you know, this is her view, and I've kind of taken on that view, that we don't wear a poppy, for the reason that until it's taught, you know, until it's expressed, until it's vocalized, that there were so many Black and brown people in those fights. Do you feel like it's a disservice in schools, no matter of where in the UK it is, that that's not spoken about?
I think it is, but I think that it's getting better. I mean, some of the sources that I referenced, like in terms of, are from like kind of national war memorials, on military people are getting wiser to the fact of including the Black and brown regiments, but it's just absolutely a disservice that hasn't happened in school. But we have to also bear in mind that this is a governmental decision at a governmental level not to invite those military regiments to victory parades, and actually to disband them without pay, under armed, under military, you know, a company, like an armed, they arrived and back in the Caribbean with armed guards, and all no pension, all of those things disqualified. We see this again and again, and I think that that's a decision, and so the ramifications of that decision are massive. I mean, there is a Black Poppy movement whereby there are people, there are organizations trying to like bring to the fore the fact that there's Black service, but this lack of Black service has created race relation problems, I think, without end. Because when, with that Lord Kitchener moment, all those people were seen as coming just after the war. So the worst things have happened, and now things are about to get better, and now all these people arrive. And that was for working class people who were told what to think, or who had helped, or that was concealed from them, because military people knew that these regiments existed. They felt that, like, you know, black communities were just interlopers, they were just coming for the good times, and they had no idea that all these people had been involved all the time in the worst times, in some of the hardest times. And that's why in the military room I show how not even just Black people serving in auxiliary spaces in the Caribbean. I've got a female officer from Trinidadian auxiliary service, but also civilians from across the Caribbean were sending things when they also didn't have much to send, but what they could, they were sending. And this is not taught, and it's created problems that need not have existed.
100%. Definitely. I think it would change the kind of rhetoric of my grandparent or my great grandparent, you know, fought in the war, for example, that now allows me to, you know, say this, do this, kind of act in this way. I think it would kind of eliminate that. I wanted to jump into the healthcare room as well, because that kind of in history takes us all the way back, you know, all the way back in terms of the bush. And I thought that was a really interesting place to start in terms of what the bush meant, also the eradication and the extinction of some of those, you know, valued plants and their properties. And then you have the knock-on effect of then though it being synthesized and patented, so the people who it was originally can no longer even create their, you know, their own version. I was telling someone today about that, and they were like, you know, that's just absolutely mind-blowing. And it's kind of, that feels purposeful, you know, that feels, I don't know, that does hurt. That hurts a lot, because you can directly see the blockages to helping people. But I thought, I wanted to know from you, you know, kind of where did that research lead you in terms of thinking into the bush? And was there anything that you thought was what surprised you?
Actually, it was all surprising. It was all the more I dug into it, the more I found it incredibly depressing, because it's, I mean, all this is so all these rooms have got personal aspects which are kind of hidden in the rooms. Like, I mean, my dad is an officer, was an officer in the British Army as a Jamaican man. My mother, my grandmother worked for the NHS as an auxiliary nurse. So I've got quite difficult relationships with all this material. And that, it felt like, I mean, sometimes it felt like it was like a cliff edge you were falling off, and you thought you'd reached bottom, and then there was another level that was just like, oh, because what I realized is about the patents, and that was just like, for me, and I had also some figures of how many Black and Brown people died because they don't have access to this medicine in a year, and it was just a shocking figure. And I just thought it was just it's really upsetting. And through community consultation, I was very worried about this, putting these things out, because I thought it's quite a lot. So we had the porch area to kind of like decompress. But people in the community were telling me even more. They were saying, so one woman explained to me, oh, but that's not the last of it, because actually all those medicines that have been patented, they've only been trialed, they've been trialed in groups that don't include ethnic minorities, so they're actually not even made for us. So we don't even have access to like a thing that might not even work for, I mean, it's just, that's, and I was like, oh, okay, right, this is another level of like awfulness. And the thing is, these plants don't exist anymore. So I just feel really, so when we think about healthcare and our contribution to healthcare, when we celebrate doctors and nurses who've assisted Britain, we need to look at that in this context, in this bigger context of healthcare, and where we are and where we have been. And there's some also difficult images about what happened to what was our healthcare on the Middle Passage, which was nothing at all. One figure in the one part of the work shares that the passage of migration of sharks was affected because of all the bodies that were the people that were in the water, and those people were thrown in the water whether they were healthy or whether they were sick, and whether if they're sick they were thrown in, if they were healthy and there was too much weight they were thrown in. So there's this history of healthcare specifically. And then I have one image which is quite upsetting. It's very upsetting about a decimated forest, and then people were moved on foot to the boats, and then if they were sick and couldn't walk anymore but still had some energy, they were tied to the stumps of the trees, so the remains of the forest, and left to die. So but they had a bit of energy, if they had no energy, were just left there, but if they had some go left, they were actually tied to those decimated trees. And there's an image of that, which is an original image which I extracted and put in the space. It's just very, very depressing. But it also to come to the contemporary issue of the earn, learn and return, in that context, We're now recruiting, and this then goes beyond the Caribbean because it's going to other black and brown places, countries. We're also recruiting from the Philippines now, and with this kind of built-in deportation. And I just think that that's in taking this bigger picture, it's really beyond shocking. And I just find that, like, I just want to put all these things in one space, because then we can begin to really appreciate, I feel like, visually.
And unpick it as well. Yes, yeah, and start to unpick it. Because I feel like we're at the edge of going into, you know, this cliff, off the cliff with you, and then we can kind of, I guess, together support one another. Thank you, Sonia. We're going to have another musical interlude. And I think it's nice to think of this as the porch moment. You know, this is the moment to reflect, get some respite, reset, go again. So this is from a dubstep producer by the name of Mala, who's from Southeast London. He's worked with a pianist called Joe Armand Jones, and it's called The Truth. That's a really from a great project. I would definitely say it's worth checking out. It kind of explores dubstep sound system culture in a modern day. Okay, so I'd like to welcome back Anthony Joseph, who's going to do another.
Jamz,
another.
Can't hear you.
Oh no! Can you hear me now? I've taken it off mute. Hello.
I can hear you.
You can hear me. Okay, you got me.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. But basically, I was just saying it's a great project from Mallow and Joel and Jones, so give it a listen. But I want to invite back Anthony Joseph for reading of another piece of work. So Anthony, the floor is yours.
Okay. So actually, the two pieces I'm going to read, the first one definitely has a lot to do with that sort of military room that we were speaking about. I'm just pulling up a better PDF. Just give me one sec. Okay. Yeah. Interestingly enough, there was a guy called George Arthur Roberts who lived on my my estate in Camberwell here. Who was a soldier in the First World War and lived. He lived here and died here in 1970, and there's a plaque for him. So the first piece is called Pride. And while not dedicated to him, it's about him, and it's about a sense of pride that a lot of Caribbean people of that generation felt for Britain for some reason. And then it's also about the pride of the caretaker of the estate, who was very, very happy to be there when this plaque was being unveiled. So, pride. They are building a memory, a blue memorial, putting up a plaque, consecrating the space where George Roberts lived. Roberts, born Trinidad, 1890, was wounded in the Somme, battalion bomber. Yet known to throw bombs like coconuts. This barrack yard, Samuel Lewis Truss, built as arms for the poor in 1815, a strong house for wounded soldiers, with wild mint in the troughs, retains its history. The caretaker, changing from overalls to soft shirt, to pose at the unveiling, with the mayor and his livery collar. Rare groover, West London, Jamaican, London soul man. It is the first time I have seen him take off his hat. So that poem was one of three poems that were published in an anthology that came out in 2018, which is called Unwritten. I don't know if people can see it. Maybe it's too blurred. It's called Unwritten Caribbean Poems After the First World War. So it came out to celebrate the 70th anniversary of Windrush. And this is the second poem. And I was really inspired by reading accounts by Caribbean soldiers who actually fought in World War I about the things that they had to carry with them. It's this inventory. One ration tin to be drunk till sulfur dreg, one spiked trench club, jujube, a prayer shawl, shroud of Avignon, lion of Montpellier. Finally put to front from slave work, and we saw battle, front line of Palestine and trench, sent letters, one Bryant and May matchbox and matchbox holder and rum jug, and cut plug of gold block, tobacco in tin foil, one fly whisk to wish fly off gone off sweet cake, and race the black face burst or blackens, maculates, dirty bone, frost bit, amputates, the staccato tattoo rolls over the ridge, explodes into language, into sound which burst through the tongue, to stiffen the jaw into a riff for drama, to put glue in his throat, pith, pith, the bayonet which split the helmet like a sonnet. And the last piece is actually lyrics for a song called Calling England Home, which actually started as a poem. It didn't start as a song. It started as a poem that I then recorded with my band. It was made into a song accompanied by music. And it came out on an album called The Rich Are Only Defeated When Running for Their Lives, which came out last year. What else can I say about this piece? Well, this piece, there are three verses. And in each of the verses, I go through a particular generation of people, of Caribbean people that have come to the UK from the Caribbean. So in the first verse, we're dealing with the more sort of Windrush generation, people that came in 1940s, mid-1940s, 48, 49 in particular. And then in the second verse, we move to 1959, because, you know, people were coming all of these years, and that's a particular sort of, you know, the generation that inspired the sort of Black Power movements here. And then in the final verse, I talk about my own experience of coming here in 1989. So, calling England home. Black and been here since 1949. West London jaw grind. Take it easy. We saw him, you saw him, walking along the canal last night. And what a joy to buck up upon him at the carnival today, to hear him speak about the dances and the bands at the Paramount, the spots you couldn't mix with white in, remembering London. How he been slapped so hard with the lash, Sam Selvon say, and it take him 60 years before he could call England home. He must have come here in black and white, 1959, time longer than twine. So long ago, he don't remember being a child, just a suit and steamer trunk upon a ship which took a good 6 weeks to cross. We sat at his kitchen table and I filmed him on the fly, but he wasn't saying much, at least nothing I could put in a poem. Instead, he showed me photographs with the dashiki and the fez, with Michael X at the ambiance. Outside, the night came in, and he had moved so far away from calling England home. I've lived here longer than home, since 1989. Remember Harles then, in the springtime? I used to walk from Cricklewood to Marylebone High Street to cut up meat to punch out dough. I was never asked to wait tables or to serve scones and coffee. I worked in the basement. But I learned to tie my apron in a way which retained some dignity. And in my first summer above the corner shop, I listened to Rare Groove on pirate radio. I was flung so far from any notion of nation. How long do you have to live in a place before you can call it home? Thank you.
Wow. Thank you, Anthony. Yeah, again, you know, more powerful words. I could really see you, in a sense, you know, in 1989, and kind of, I guess, would you say that your journey here has been bittersweet in terms of it's home, but does it always feel like home?
It feels like home now, because I've been here longer than I actually lived in Trinidad, you know. So, but I think, you know, I think we're tied to this idea that we can only have one home, you know. I think I have two homes. I think I have a home that's always in Trinidad. That's always, you know, because that's the first place I knew who I was. So that's always going to be my spiritual and my physical home as well. That's where I'm at home. But I live here. I live in London. I've lived here for many years, and I like living here. You know, I have family here, so here's home as well. You know,
yeah.
Actually, when I'm in Trinidad, I look forward to coming back. And when I'm here, I look forward to going to Trinidad. So it's like there's two things, there's 2 degrees of home, you know, and they're both valid.
I believe that. I think that can definitely be true. I think the notion that you have to discount one to embrace the other, or vice versa. Right. And I guess another experience that some people have is that, let's say if they're first generation, you know, I don't know if you have, you know, children, if they were to be told to go back home, but to go back where, you know, this is home, you know, in terms of they don't have necessarily have that duality, or to be in Trinidad and not feel like, you know, that is always home. Do you think that the Windrush has had a kind of direct, or no, let me rephrase that, has the Windrush had a direct impact on you, and in what way?
I think first of all, the Windrush is one ship. You know, I think the actual Windrush itself was one ship, and we talk about it as a period in historical time, which, you know, it kind of is. It's come to represent that period of time from after World War II up until the late 50s or whatever. That's the Windrush period, sure. So I think that period, historical period, has had a huge influence on every sort of aspect of Black culture that we see visibly in the UK now. I mean, that introduced a lot of cultural turning points, you know, through that experience of people coming during that time. We got Carnival, you know, we got the Notting Hill Carnival, we got a lot of, we got reggae, we got calypso in the UK, you know. It changed a lot of things. The people that came during that time changed the UK permanently, changed a lot of things. It changed ideas about belonging, you know, home. One of the things that I found in my research was that prior to that period, people in Britain, there was no sort of real identity crisis, in the sense that they believed they were just British. It was just Britain, and that was it. And then suddenly after World War II, and with the empire crumbling and people starting coming to the UK, suddenly there became this question about, well, what actually is British? You know, what does it actually mean to be English? And I think that the Windrush movement has a part to play in the way British people have defined themselves. And that's quite important. You know, it's because of that influx of people from the Caribbean and questioning, what is it actually to be British? You know, that we have this situation where during the 50s and the 60s and into the 70s, people are redefining what it means, you know. And I think that's a contribution, you know.
Yeah.
Apart from the cultural contribution, there's an intellectual contribution as well, you know. Yeah. So, it has impacted on me and my work, and, you know, the fact that I came here in the first place and wanted to stay, and, you know, was able to work and was able to find a space, you know, because there were people that came before me and sort of, you know, created paths and roads for me to walk behind, you know. So, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I'd like to invite back Sonia, because I love the way that, actually, I think, you know, big shout out to the Up guys, because the programming has been spot on. You know, you are on these parallel journeys of research, and out of it comes your creativity. With you, Anthony, you know, it's what we read and what we can hear. And with you, Sonia, it's what we can see. So how does each other's work make you feel? So when you know, Sonia, let's start with you. When you hear Anthony's work, what sort of feelings come up for you?
Oh, it's wonderful to hear these ideas being articulated. I mean, what's really quite powerful is the point of view that's taken. I mean, where would we hear from the man who's in the basement cutting up the meat? Like, that's really powerful. And the quiet dignity in that poem, and like how that tools, how do you find dignity? Like in the way I tie my apron is that, you know, like this little ritual is like a kind of a way. You can see that path of something that would happen many, you know, multiple times during the day. When you leave, you take your apron off. When you come in, you put your apron. And it's like these little, I mean, for me visually, I'm interested in what are the tools that we can use to lift us up out of objectification. And I see in that recording of that verbalization of the action, that noticing the action, that's a tool in the toolkit to really take you out of a space of objectification and really, you know, to claim other people might look and not see anything when they just see the apron, but it's something for him. He does that for himself and he knows things are right now, you know, proper. And I think that's really interesting.
Yeah, and for you, yeah. Anthony, you know, been going on the walkthrough of Sonia's work, what things came up for you?
I think I think a lot of things came to mind. One of the things that came to mind was that it is taking that moment and that period in history, it's kind of taking it into the future. You know, I think the work, being able to present the work on this sort of, you know, interactive level, means that a lot more people have access to it, and it moves away from just being the, you know, we started with just the Pathé film, you know, and now we're in a space where we could walk through a room virtually, you know, and see the impact of these people. So I think that's amazing. It also reminded me of a quote from Pearl Connor, who years ago, who was a Trinidadian, she was an activist and artists, she managed a lot of artists and stuff in the 50s and 60s. And she said that there is no record of the contributions that Black people have made to British culture. There's a crack and we fall, there's a hole in the ground and we fall through it, you know? And I think it's like all of these contributions of people like Kitchener and people who were around at that time, they're lost, you know, they get lost, and it's up to people like Sonia and like myself to try to keep them above ground. And I think that's what Sonia is doing, keeping it above ground so the stories are visible and we can see them permanently, you know? So I think that's important.
And we're in this really interesting time, I think, where this I can speak for my generation, are kind of really open and receptive to relearning the things that we weren't taught, and kind of having sort of all this sort of, you know, wealth of information to do that. And I think, you know, I do think that the events of 2020 have a big part to play in that, and kind of given us the space to go back and to look, and we have your work to kind of aid us. I've got some questions that have come in, so feel free to keep on dropping them. The Slido link is in the chat. We'll have about 10 to 15 minutes worth of questions. So this one's for Sonia, it's for Jeff. He said, your digital work is fascinating. So could people add to it? And is Rashmi a living environment that can expand as it includes more lived experiences? So can people add to it, and will it expand?
In a word, yes. The point is that people can drop other things there. So there are areas with shelves, so you can drop an object that could be digitized or a text. You can respond something, you can bring something else in. I see digital space as infinite, but it's kind of not, because I've discovered if I put too much into a room, it could crash. So yes, it could expand, would require more rooms to add on, but that's absolutely the point. And yes.
Sort of says on the site, it's like what it starts off was will not be what it ends up as. I think that's quite interesting.
Yes, so it should maybe at one point you can't even see the starting points that I've started. It's just be some thing what other people have brought and think is important. And I quite like that idea. So it's kind of a living, should organically grow.
Yeah. Another question we have, although we were brought to support health, I love the thought process of what else can healthcare be? Could you expand on Damien Hirst's medical cabinet?
Okay, so to take those two as two parts. So the first part is what health can be. I have a evasion grid where I've just like picked out like members of the Black community here who I think are trying to understand what else healthcare could be within our communities. And I think they're really digging into that, and they're all their leads, and I think that's really exciting. As regards to Damien Hirst, I was so interested in that work on medicine. It's been read so many different ways, but I don't think anyone's really brought the race into it. And I feel like race is definitely really important in medicine, and race and the environment. So I see race, environment, and gender, especially, all being one problem as opposed to these separate things. So for Damien Hirst, as a very successful male British artist with his medicine cabinet, for me to come and make just a tiny meme of it and put the bars on it is imprisonment is like a big act, really, because we have to understand that in this country the Windrush scandal is basically people, Black and brown people in this country, who are citizens, are presenting themselves for healthcare when they have healthcare needs is when they end up being deported. So that path, that healthcare path, was that because at one point doctors were being recruited in this country to help this deportation progress, called in the so-called hostile environment. So that those bars on Hearst medicine cabinet have many meetings. One of those is that reference to that deportation when presenting for medical care, and people not presenting for medical care because they were afraid that it would lead to deportation, which is another whole other tragedy. But particularly this locking up of medicines which have been effectively stolen, destroyed, synthesized, not for us. So there's this many locking up and removing from us. So for me, that's all in that little chest there. And it sits next to the other chest, which is like what medicines were here before the tropical medicines were synthesized, which was not very much, to be honest. So, but ironically, in a mahogany box. So those two boxes are sitting next to each other, and they kind of speak to each other, I feel. So that's some of the layers of that.
Another question, which I'm actually going to throw to Anthony first, and then I'll bring the question back around to you, Sonia. So it was both of you kind of have delved into the Caribbean military experience through your work. Anthony, when you saw the contemporary posters that were in Sonia's room, you know, the kind of the millennial, the selfie, the self-belief, the me, aimed at young Black people. How did that make you feel?
Well, I'm not surprised. I mean, this is where we are. This is part of a whole sort of campaign of inclusivity, I think. I'm not sure if I'm qualified enough to critique that. Think it's I don't know. I mean, it's the Black body is always a problematic space, and there's always been a politically politicized space, so I'm seeing now, with the wake of in the wake of George Floyd and in the wake of the Black Lives Matter movement, I'm seeing a lot more visibility and a lot more of these images, and I'm just wondering where does it go from here, whether or not we're going to be still seeing this in a couple of years. How is it going to evolve? I'm really interested in how is it going to evolve after the space that we're in now, where there's a lot of inclusivity and a lot of exposure and a lot of visibility, and a lot of, which feels like a lot of doors opening and a lot of opportunities. And, you know, I'm interested in seeing where it goes. So, you know, that's the sort of question that comes to mind when I see images like that. What happens next?
Yeah. I guess it can be quite uncomfortable because you don't, the space in which the inclusivity they're asking for, or whether that is a safe space for these people. And for you, Sonia, you know, someone had asked, you know, what platforms were these contemporary recruitment posters advertised on? And I'm going to add one in. Why did you feel the need to include them?
So these are actual advertisements that the British Army ran themselves. It's their own advertising campaign. So the first one was from the British government, particularly that one in the Bahamas, but they were similar ones in Trinidad, in Jamaica, in across the islands. And I wanted to put the modern ones there because I thought it's so interesting how this recruitment process that's happening, let's look at this, especially with all these other different types of warriors in the room. I found it shocking myself, but I didn't really want to take a position. I thought it was more interesting to just put them in the space and to see, like, to just say, okay, after looking at this, like, how is this for you? What happens now? What is this doing with you? But I did think that the last poster, which was, you know, offering a place to belong, was particularly poignant because there's this history of exclusion. And like, if the place we could belong is a bombed out house in some war torn area, I mean, it just seems to me to be particularly inappropriate. But you know, there's lots of ways to read those posters, and so they're just put all together on the back wall, and there's room for people to think about that. And as we can see, because of the warriors in the room, like fighting for the British Army or working for or being part of the Navy or the Air Force is not a new thing for Black people. I mean, you can see there are lots of people in the room that have done that before with different outcomes. So I just think in that context, it's interesting to look at those posters, and you know, interested in expanding out to the past, but also in like reaching out to the future and just colliding them in this room, just drilling down, just looking at military. So,
yeah. Well, what do you think we can, you know, having taken all the research that you've done for this project and Anthony as well, you know, the work and the research that you've been doing, you know, throughout your time as an artist, what do you think we can learn from the Windrush generation, or what should we take away from this experience that our foreparents and grandparents and ancestors have gone through? Anthony, you can take this one first.
That's a hard question. What can we learn? Gosh, I don't know. I mean, I'm not a fan of saying we have to learn resilience and we have to learn strength and we have to be, you know, as strong as they were. I don't know, because I think they endured a lot of hardship, a lot of things that they didn't have to endure, that they shouldn't have endured. So I'll be honest, I think one of the things that we have to learn is to not have the sort of attitudes that they had when they came. They came almost, it felt like asking to be let in, almost asking to belong, you know. And I think we've moved away from that now. And luckily we've moved into a space where the struggle for belonging is not so profound as it was for them, you know. So I think we can move away from always having to sort of, you know, this sort of imposter syndrome where we're looking for a place and we don't feel at home, and you know, how long do we have to live here before we can call it home? I think we can move away from that. So I think that's something we've learned over time, how to center yourself in a space, I think, is one of the things we've learned. But you know, for me, I'm in a particularly interesting situation because I wasn't here in the 70s and the 80s. I didn't grow up here. I grew up in Trinidad. So sort of Black, that period of Black British history, the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, a really pivotal, important period, but I wasn't here for that, you know. So in a lot of ways, I can't really comment on the sort of political delivery of the Windrush, because a lot of the things that the Windrush generation contributed were their children, you know, the children, the second generation, second and third generations, and their experiences are pivotal to where we are now. So, but I feel like I've missed out on that because I wasn't here. So I don't know. I don't know if Sonia was here, if you, you know, if you grew up in the UK during that period.
So I grew up in lots of different places, but I kept coming back to Britain because my grandparents are here. So my West Indian grandparents who lived in London in Wood Green. And so I kept coming in and seeing this and then seeing something else, seeing Africa, seeing Cyprus, seeing Hong Kong. So I always had this counterpoint. But I mean, when I think about what did I learn from what can we learn from the Windrush generation, or what could I learn from my grandmother? I feel that I can learn a lot from my great grandmother. And actually during lockdown, I started to really get into planting gardens, and I took a qualification in permaculture. And when I'd finished, which is a kind of way of gardening with the soil and the earth. And when I finished, I realized I've done all these degrees and I've just done another qualification just to begin to know a little bit of what my great grandmother already knew. Long time, like before even though she didn't leave Jamaica, she had all this already, and I was thinking these systems are familiar. And so I think there's a lot to learn, not just only from the Windrush generation, but the generation before the Windrush, and the generations that stretch back into our very long history that were on the continent before that. So I'm very open to learning, and I'm just very excited not to just focus on the Windrush generation, but also on all that was before them as well, because that's a very long, long history. And speaking with members of the Windrush who actually, of the groups that started this celebration of Windrush, they're very adamant that they're not immigrants, that they are citizens and they came as citizens. And this is something they will correct you on again and again. And they really like, distance themselves from the idea of being immigrants. They don't understand themselves. They understand themselves as citizens coming to a country that they have citizenship, and that's how they explain it. And I think that that's really, really interesting. That anticipation, that expectation of citizenship. And I think that's something that we could perhaps learn from as well. You know, but I love this idea of yes, as Moon has just said, centering ourselves in a space. As a belonging. I think that's wonderful, but I think that maybe some of the Windrush people were expecting to do that. They were expecting to be centered in the space. I do feel like it was surprising because they knew so much about Britain, but British people knew nothing about them. So there was this imbalance, and this was not an accidental imbalance. And that's the heart of, I think that gets to the heart of so many problems, as well as this erasure of the contributions. It's a double-edged thing.
Yeah, but don't you think that the idea of citizenship and all of that belonging that they anticipated or they felt wasn't that part of this sort of imperial propaganda at the time that made them feel that this was something that was theirs? And actually when they came, it wasn't. They couldn't find it.
Yeah, I mean, even my granddad, he sent me a picture of my great-grandma with the ticket, the boat ticket to come over. And I was like, oh, was she part of Windrush? He was like, no, she wasn't Windrush. She was invited. And there's this, I was like, okay, but what year? And, you know, it's within that period. But there was the counteraction of being like, no, she was invited. She wasn't, you know, Windrush. But that, you know, I just thought that was really interesting, you know, that he felt the need to express that. Maybe that goes back to there's not a distinction, but in his sense of belonging as to how he got here, maybe that's what he needs, you know. I'm going to go through a few more questions before we wrap it up, and we'll end with a song. So we've had something in from Webinar. They're based in Birmingham. They're part of the National Windrush 75 Committee. How can we ensure both of these works are shared? So I guess this panel discussion and your Sonia as well, how can we assure that it's shared?
I don't know. I mean, Anthony's books are available for purchase.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, buy it.
They're out there. Read, bought. And this pay, the piece is online. The Rushby work is online, and you can enter it. I think we might be doing that at the end. And so as long as it's online and up, it will be accessible to people. Those are the ways, I think.
Amazing. Yeah. And this will be available on YouTube after. And someone said, will this ever be turned into a VR space where we can physically walk around too? Would that be your hope, Sonia? Would you like to? Does it need to be made into a physical space?
It could be. What's interesting for me about the virtual space is that it means that people from the Caribbean and from Britain can access the space. And also it means that I had a lot of contributions also from outside of London. It means that can happen too. But of course, it would be exciting to do that as well. Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Well, yeah, hopefully we can make that happen. I wanted to get maybe Anthony and Sonia, just I guess your lasting thoughts after, you know, kind of the discussions that we've had. Is there anything that you'd like to impart on people who are watching this, or any lasting thoughts, any lasting quotes, any lasting questions that you want to pose as we continue this conversation?
I have just one thing I would say is that it's really important to collect stories. You know, it's really important for us, the generation that the Windrush, so-called Windrush generation, there aren't a lot of them around. You know, people are getting older and people are passing away, and it's really important to capture their stories, you know, take photos of them, capture what evidence they have of their time here, you know, do the research, find out who they were, find out about their lives, record it somewhere. Otherwise, you know, as Pearl says, we're going to fall through the hole. And you know, I think it's the responsibility of artists, like, you know, myself, like Sonia, and writers, poets, musicians, or whatever. We become the biographers, we become the historians, because so much of our history is lost, so much is gone, so much has been eroded, you know. So it's important that we sort of keep things together as well, keep things archived and everything. And we need help from other people who can collect the stories. So keep collecting your stories of your grandparents and whatever. That's what I would suggest that we do.
That's brilliant. Yeah. Thank you, Anthony. And Sonia?
I think that's wonderful to do. I mean, and so in the short film, there is a moment where we have someone from the Windrush generation literally flies our own plane and waves goodbye. And it's like, really, at the moment, there's that moment for me of like, you know, we're losing you. And it, and that's how this really short film ends. But I just feel that not only to collect those things, but to think about what happened before their stories, but also to think, how can we relate that to what's happening to us now? How does that make the fights, or the issues and the situations we have now, how does that affect those situations? Like, I mean, Belly, or people in the military, or the nurse that's coming over or is about to come over from the Caribbean to work in the NHS. Like, how do we can relate those archives to our situation now, and to some of the things that we're struggling with, which are very similar, unfortunately, to things that happened during the Windrush time, or very recognizable for those individuals. That would be, for me, I think, really, really important, but also very important to say, you know, thank you for people who've taken this time to now to come here and listen to me and Anthony and hear some of your musical interlude jams, which was really, really so lovely. And also thanks to people who've sponsored our projects, and Michael Barrington Hibbets, who generously enabled this work to happen at all.
Yeah, brilliant. Well, I'm going to hand back over to Lily, who wants to jump back in and kind of to wrap it all up. So come through, Lily.
Hi, everyone. Thank you all, Anthony, Sonia, Jamz, for such a fantastic conversation. It was really thought-provoking. It was great to see how much synergy there was between Sonia and Anthony's work. And Jamz, thank you for bringing that out so well. There's a few thanks that I think we need to share for tonight. Firstly, I'd like to thank Lizzie and Francis, our BSL interpreters, for interpreting this event. We're very grateful to have you here today. And to the audience for participating and for all of your comments and questions throughout the evening. And thanks for bearing with us through some of the technical difficulties we had. Rushmi, the artwork that inspired this event tonight, was over 5 months in the making, and it was an incredible process for us as an organization to be a part of. So I wanted to say a massive thank you to Sonia for producing this work. I know that it was personal, challenging, thought-provoking all at once, and it was such an intense process, but the work is such an incredible contribution to UP Project's portfolio of digital commissions. And we're really proud to have it as part of This is Public Space, our digital commissions program. I also wanted to thank Maureen, who is our programmer, for her incredible technical development and creative assistance. And as Sonia already mentioned, Michael Barrington Hibbett Associates for funding the commission. We really want to listen and build on the audience's feedback for future events. So Jack will be posting a link in the chat. So if you could give us any feedback, that would be great. We will be uploading both a visual and audio recording of today's event on our YouTube channel that will include both captions and BSL interpretation, which you'll be able to access from the UP Project's website. We would all like to now encourage you to go check out Rushmi. Again, Jack will post a link in the chat that you can all go and explore. And last but not least, I'd love to thank Jasmine Bell and Jack Newberry for all your technical assistance and programming expertise tonight and everything you've done in the lead up to this event. So thank you all and have a good night. And I think we'll outro with the very last song that Jamz had planned. So I'll play that for you all now. An X that plugs this book.